Welcome everybody to the last regular talk of today. So only one talk to go, and then there's a keynote speech. I hope you all are still motivated and fresh in mind. Actually, I'm not so fresh anymore, but that is more because I have a newborn child at home, a daughter, and she likes to sleep, but she doesn't like to sleep at the right time. So, but I think we will get through it. So, today I will talk about a little bit about not only the COVID certificate app, but also, but specifically about three projects that have to do with the SwissCovid systems in general that we did during the pandemic. I mean, it's still ongoing, but we're kind of in the end game now, so hopefully it's soon over. So what I will talk about today is basically not specifically about the apps that you all know and have, I guess, but about more about the back-end systems that are not so well known, although all of it is open source and you could look it up on GitHub if you like. And I will give you the background story, basically how these projects happened and what the challenges were and what our solutions are for them. So one quick note, I will use the acronyms, the German acronyms for our, the federal offices, because the English acronyms are not so well known. So the Federal Office of Information Technology System and Telecommunication, which is FOITT, which I will call BIT because it's shorter and nobody uses the English acronyms anyway. So that is where I'm from. I'm a system architect there. I will give some points about me in a minute. And there's also the Federal Office of Public Health, which is the BAG, which I guess you already heard about it. And also the Federal Statistical Office, which is the BFS, and the Federal Customs Administration, which is EZV. So keep that in mind if I mention them, but I guess you already forgot that, so, but it's not so important. So 2 points about me, myself. I'm working at BIT now for roughly 5 years. Before that, I was no stranger to working in some crisis, so to say. I just thought maybe these 2 points you can also see in my CV, but it's not so obvious. So I was a postdoc in Japan during the Fukushima incident. Actually, I flew there 3 days after the incident, so that was quite an interesting time. I was not working in some projects related to the crisis there, but in the environment there. And I also worked in T-Systems International in Germany during the refugee crisis. I was actually in the BAMF, in the Federal Office of Immigration and Refugees there, doing some projects, which was also interesting. And now I'm at BIT, and I was the solution architect for basically all the projects related to all the COVID apps and systems. So to give you a little bit background about what BIT is, because maybe it's not so well known, and normally the federal office, they don't give so many speeches in public, because I'm not sure why, but they just don't do it. So the BIT itself, described in three numbers, is the main IT provider of the federal administration. I mean, basically it's one of six service providers, and our customers are just all the other federal offices. So in total it's around 52. It's a little bit fluctuating because there's always some restructuring and stuff like that. We operate 2 data centers, and we develop and operate around 500 applications inside these 2 data centers. And yeah, basically that's it. So our customers is actually not the public itself, but the federal offices, so keep that in mind. And a little bit about the environment, because that is important later in the story, is how the IT is structured or organized in the federal administration. So basically you have the 6 service providers, which BIT is the biggest one, but there are also others. And you have the other federal offices, which can do some projects with us or the other service providers, but they can also go to the open market. So they can use whatever service they like or whatever provider they choose to work with. But there's one catch. There's this one number, which is €250,000. So if the project or the service that you want to consume is more expensive than that, calculated over 4 years, then you have to make a public tender. And the public tender always means that you have to wait at least 1 year to start your project. So if you want to have something fast, you have to come to us, basically. And that is also, I mean, basically that's what happened later with the COVID certificate, but we will come to that. So that is the environment. The talker itself is about three projects, which I said was the solution architect for. This is the proximity tracing system, which was very early in the pandemic. Maybe you remember that. And the second one is the contact tracing database. That is the federal or the national contact tracing database. And the last one, which I said, is the COVID certificate project. There are two other smaller projects, which I've mentioned here, just to have the whole picture, which is the COVID-19 dashboard. Maybe you have seen that already. And the travel check, where you can just check the regulations for different countries where you want to travel. These are smaller ones, and I was not related to them directly, so I will skip that. So the three projects, if you overlay the pandemic waves, so to say, over it, are structured in a way that the SwissCovid app, which is the proximity tracing system, was the first one we did, and which was also the most challenging one from a technical perspective, but I will come to that later. And the second one, which was started before the second wave, which is the national contact tracing database. So if you had COVID at that time and somebody was calling you and talking about basically your contacts that you had in the past, these information would be stored firstly in cantonal contact tracing databases and then transferred to the national one, so to aggregate all the data. We will see that in detail later. And that project lasted around 6 months because the cantons are a little bit reluctant to give out their data. So, but we will see that later. And then the last one is the COVID certificate project, which we all use today to come here to the conference and have access. So that is the outline of the talk. And now we'll dig a little bit deeper in the different projects. So the first one is the SwissCovid app, which started last year in April. And the pilot phase started in May, end of May, so roughly around 2 months of development in this project. And then there was a wide release. So the release for the whole public was in June, end of June. And of course, there was also the some laws involved that has to be passed in the parliament and stuff like that. So that's why there's another month there until the wide release, although the app itself and all the systems were already ready in the pilot phase. So maybe a little bit background and refreshing, because the proximity tracing is a little bit old and not so much in the press anymore, because now it's all about the COVID certificate, of course. So the basic idea is this kind of decentralized proximity tracing. So basically, it's an automatic way of, it's not contact tracing in a sense, because it's forward moving, but basically you record all the encounters you had, if the encounters were long enough, and you exchange Bluetooth keys with the app, and they store it locally. So there's no centralized data store here for these kind of key exchanges. And then if you are infected, basically you can mark yourself as infected, which is totally free. I mean, you don't have to do it, it's voluntary. And then all the other contacts that you had in that time are basically informed that they had contact with somebody who has now COVID, and they should also isolate themselves. This is done through some backend system, and today we will talk about more about that backend system, because in the original white paper it's just basically a black box, yeah, and it's also not outlined in detail how the user, the diagnosed patients, gets the code to input there. So for each of these projects, we will see basically the basic idea. Then I will show you the backend UIs, because they're not so much known, and maybe it's interesting to see how it looks for the health authorities, for the doctors and stuff like that. And then I will go into detail and show you all the services that we built, and also the main challenge of that project, and also the solution of that project. So hopefully that's interesting. So the COVID code UI, so basically the UI that you can, that the doctor can generate the COVID code that they can give you, and then you can input in your mobile app, basically looks like this. It's quite simple. You just have a login button here, then you have two-factor authentication with the federal authentication or the IAM solution, and then you have that screen where you just basically click a button and get a code. So it's very simple. You also have to input the date where you got infected, basically, because that is important later for the key exchange. And basically that's it. Yeah. That is the whole system for the doctors. And if we look at that system in a more detailed view, it looks like this. So you have basically three parts or three components of that system. Basically, our project manager was mainly into colors. So all of the parts of the system are named as colored systems. So we have the black system, we have the red system, and we have the gray system. The black system basically is what I've showed you just now. It's the UI and the backend for the health authorities, for the doctors. And the red system is everything that is related to the mobile app. So it's the mobile app itself and the backends, basically. And the gray system is the European gateway. There's a little bit special story behind that, because at that time when we developed that system, there was a little bit of a dispute, basically, with the European Union, with the Rahmenabkommen. Yeah. Not sure if you remember that. And as Switzerland is not a European country in the close sense, yeah, we could not connect to the European Federation gateway directly, but we have to do around a little bit trick there. That's why in the SwissCovid app, if you look at it in the information tab, you see that the keys are only exchanged with Liechtenstein and Germany. That is because the European gateway basically is open source, so we deployed our Swiss European gateway in our environment and then just connected bilaterally these countries through the gateways itself. So it's a little bit kind of a workaround, but there was no other way to do it in that sense. And I also don't recommend to use the color system here, because we also had some colorblind people in our project, and it's very hard to talk about this red system when, you know. But anyway, he really wanted to use that, so there was no talking out of it. So we have these three basically domains. I mean, we didn't do, honestly, fully-fledged domain-driven design, but you can look at it as domains in that sense. And in each of these domains, if we look at it in detail, for the SwissCovid app, we have these kind of microservices. So we have an API gateway, which was used to connect all the third-party systems who also wanted to generate SwissCovid codes in a machine-to-machine manner, not using the UI. There's a certificate-based authentication system there. Then we have the health authority UI, the code generation backend, for the black system, which uses Keycloak here as IAM solution, which is connected to the official, so to say, IAM solution of the federal government or the federal administration, which is called EIM. The E is for electronic, I guess. I have not found what the E really stands for, so I cannot tell you that. But basically, the key point here for using Keycloak is that the official IAM solution of the federal administration only uses SAML as a security protocol, and we didn't want to use SAML because it's a little bit heavyweight, so we wanted to use OpenID Connect. So Keycloak here is only used as an IDP broker, basically. And we are also using PostgreSQL as the database of choice for the different microservices. So everywhere there's a PostgreSQL marker, basically that is a single database. The red system basically is the config service, which is used for configuration items and also the text that you see in the app. Then they have the backend service, of course, where you can upload the keys. We have the interop service, which connects to the gateway. As I've told you, we used the open source version of the European gateway and deployed it in our environment by ourselves, and then connected it to the other backends, so to say, of the other countries. What I've also put down here is the kind of manpower we use to realize these systems. So that there's always the teams that were chosen for these microservices, for these domains to realize them. So we have a team from BIT, which is one UI and two backend developers. Of course, there were also testers and requirement engineers and stuff like that. But I only mentioned here the coders, basically, who really put in some work. And the apps itself and also the backends and also the gateway was developed and operated by Ubique. And they had six front-end and three back-end developers on the project. All of these are Angular UI apps or Spring Boot services, 12-factor apps in the for this kind of thing. Why 12-factor apps? Because the technical foundation for all of these projects is our PaaS platform that we have at BIT. And this PaaS platform is structured in the following way. I mean, it's basically three layers that you can see. It's a traditional layer, so to say, which is just a virtual compute, which is just the hypervisor that we are using, which is VMware vSphere. And there we can basically deploy virtual machines. On top of these virtual machines, we have a Kubernetes cluster running. And on top of the Kubernetes cluster, we have Cloud Foundry running. So these are the layers of our platform, which we realized the SwissCovid app and also the COVID certificate and also the contact tracing database on. So as you might know, maybe, or I'm not sure how many people here used Cloud Foundry before. Okay, not so many. Kubernetes? Okay, that's what I thought. So Cloud Foundry basically, I would say, is the older brother of Kubernetes, but you can argue about that. Basically, Cloud Foundry is a little bit more opinionated platform, and its opinion is that you have to develop apps on it in a 12-factor way. So all the backing services are outside the platform. And for our platform, we are using the Kubernetes layer to deploy all our backing services. So the PostgreSQL databases, they live in the Kubernetes layer. We also have other services like Keycloak, they also live there. We are using service operators and stuff like that to provide a self-service portal for the developers inside of Cloud Foundry. And and the apps itself, the back-end services, all the services that I showed you, they are living, so to say, in Cloud Foundry. They are developed there. Yeah, that is basically the platform we are working on. And that platform is now around 4 years old. So it's quite established in Bit. And it's also quite big. We have around 100 nodes. And there are around 150 to 160 applications already running on that platform. So it's quite big. And it's also an interesting topic to talk about, but we are not talking about it now. Just to show you that the platform we develop these kind of apps is very elastic and can be scaled and stuff like that in a very easy way, as you know from Kubernetes. And the same is true for Cloud Foundry apps. But the challenge here was this, basically. I'm not sure who is familiar with that. Okay, at least one. So you bought one of these?
No, but I read about it in the newspaper.
Ah, okay. Yeah. I mean, the story about around here is these Roger Federer coins were basically, you couldn't buy them in a Swiss Mint shop, and the Swiss Mint shop is also run inside of the Bit environment. It's not run on the platform I showed you, it's the SAP shop. And I wasn't aware that Roger Federer is so popular here, but it seems he is, yeah. So at the time that went live, at December 2019, basically the whole infrastructure crashed in around 1 hour because they had so many requests there that it was too much. It seems it was 2.5 million clicks in 1 hour or something. So so our fear was, because we were releasing basically the SwissCovid app for the whole population of Switzerland, and of course our hope was that all of you download it and use it, that our infrastructure cannot handle it. I mean, the problem is that if you look at the coin, it looks a little bit like that. So you have that coin, the inner part is elastic because you have Kubernetes, you have Cloud Foundry, which you can scale basically endlessly because we have CI/CD pipelines and stuff like that to do that. But the outer part of the coin is very hard. So it's very hard to scale it. Yeah? You have the network and the load balancers, which in our case are not software defined, but which are a little bit old-fashioned. I mean, we are changing that now, but at that time, it was when there was a ticket system, yeah, for the load balancers. If you want to scale them, you have to wait 3 to 5 days, yeah, to scale it. So it's a little bit not so elastic. So of course we could scale it in advance, but I mean these are hardware appliances. So how many appliances should we buy in advance? Yeah, it was a little bit tricky, but I mean. There's an obvious solution to this challenge, which is you make the edge of the coin elastic. And the way to do it, of course, is to you go to the public cloud, yeah, which normally is no-brainer. So in our case, we used AWS CloudFront. But as we are in the federal space, I showed you in the beginning that if that thing costs more than $250,000, you have to do a public tender. Now, I've showed you we had 2 months to realize that. There's no way you make a public tender, yeah. So our luck was that SwissTopo actually had already done a public tender for AWS, and we could use that to basically buy the resources we needed in that case. And also it helped that the project manager was the former, basically, CTO of SwissTopo, so that was a little bit lucky, yeah. So that's how we basically manage that challenge. So basically to make the coin elastic, and then there was no problem whatsoever. And it also, I mean, there was a whole discussion in the parliament about this specifically here, to use AWS for this kind of thing. And also I was in the beginning, when I prepared the talk, I was advised not to mention AWS so much here, but I mean, that is the technical solution, so there's no way around it. And I think for technical people, it's a no-brainer, yeah. So So basically that solved the problem of the GET requests. So each phone, basically each mobile app is getting all the newly published keys, the seed keys from the DP3T protocol, I think every hour or so. And that solved it. I mean, there's also a post request. If you are infected and you input the code, then you also do some posts to the backend, which is not going over CloudFront, but we figured if there are so many post requests, then we have a bigger problem with the pandemic than this, so that was okay. And it, of course, it also helped that initially we thought it was quite popular, the SwissCovid app, but I mean, now it's around 2.6 million users, so it's not quite popular as we expected. So that is the first project. Now we come to a little bit more traditional project for the BIT, that is the Federal Contact Tracing Database. So it also it started around after basically the release of the SwissCovid app. And the MVP 1 was released roughly 1 month later. So we see a pattern emerging here. Yeah, all the projects had to be released very fast. I mean, 1 or 2 months. 2 months was already a little bit long for this kind of project. But you see the wide release was roughly 6 months later. And I will come to that later, why that is the case. I mean, it's written there. So basically the problem was we had built the system, but there was no data in it because the cantons didn't want to give us the data, or they were not ready to give us the data. So how does it look like? So as I said, and also showed you in the platform overview, that's a very traditional project. So it's basically, it's not microservices. Basically, it's ready-made components that you install and run. And so basically, it's one system, one big monolith, so to say. It's a database plus some analytics capabilities. I mean, this project is still ongoing, so there's the idea to make an analytics platform for this kind of analysis, but it's not finished yet. So if you look at it in detail, basically what it is, it's a RStudio server, professional, which is connected to a SQL server, where all the data lives. And there's some smaller services, a file importer service, and the ETL service. The ETL service is for the API consumption of the contact tracing system in Geneva, which at least at that point in time was the only contact tracing database in the cantons who provided an API. All the others used the normal, so to say, file transfer integration pattern, which is called SEDEX. SEDEX is a federal service of the BFS to connect the cantonal systems to the federal systems. So basically you have folders where you put your data in some CSV format, and then it wraps it, signs it, and transfers it to a secure server. And then you on your side have a client which then pulls the data from it. So it's a very simplistic but very secure way to integrate cantonal systems. And that project was done with a team of BIT only. It was one backend developer and two engineers. There's no UI involved because RStudio server provides the UI. You don't have to develop something here. You just have to integrate the systems. And the services in this case were .NET Core services, very traditionally, of course. And from BAG, of course, you have the data scientists who do the analysis. I asked them to provide some example analysis today, but they were not ready to disclose any of these. So I'm sorry for that, but that is the system, basically. Now, what is the challenge here? Technologically, it's not such a challenge, because basically it's just installing off-the-shelf software and using that to integrate the system. Now the challenge here was mainly the stakeholder management, because you have to remember you have to integrate all the cantonal systems. Now the cantonal systems at that time was divided around 50-50. 50% of the cantons used the same software, which is SORMAS. SORMAS is basically a kind of open source solution, which was firstly developed to track the malaria disease in Africa, and was then later adapted to also basically use for the COVID contact tracing. So 50% used that. That was a little bit easier because you only have one system which you have to integrate. But 50% of the other cantons used all kinds of solutions. So that was the challenge. And also, of course, the cantons itself, they have also contractors who develop their systems, and then you have to talk to them and to the cantons, and it takes time. Yeah, stakeholder management is never easy. Yeah, and what we wanted to get was a minimal essential data set. Now, later I have a link for that because that is public information. So basically, you can have a look and see what kind of data is collected if you had COVID. And that was the challenge here. Now, the solution is a little bit not applicable in the open space, but only in the federal space, because basically what we did was, or was what BAG did, was to write an ordinance. So basically to politely force the cantons to give us the data. Now, that is not a law, so there's no basically consequence if they don't do it. But it's an official way to approach them and say, okay, please give us the data. So also that's why it took half a year to make the system really applicable, and it was only ready after the second wave. So you can read the details here. Sorry for that, it's only available in the official languages in Switzerland, which English is not one of them, so that is only German. And in the appendix here, you can see all the data set, the minimal essential data set that is collected. So that was the solution here. Yeah. It's a little bit, yeah, can only use it in the federal space, but yeah. Now, last but not least, we have the COVID certificate, which was a lot in the press, and that there was a lot of negativity in the press before the project started, because they said, okay, we only have 1 month to realize that. Now, where does the 1 month come from? The 1 month comes from the decision point from BAG, where they officially decided to do the project with BIT. Before that, there were, I think, around 50 solutions that were in competition with us to realize that. The last one was also kind of a blockchain solution. I'm not sure. I don't know the details about it. Yeah, but I guess one of the main points was the number that I showed in the beginning, the 250,000. Yeah, because they have to realize that and operate it for 4 years within that 250,000. Otherwise, they have to do a public tender. And that's only my guess, why in the end they still did it with us. But at that point in time, we only had 1 month to realize it because summer holidays are coming at that point in time. And also there's the European solution, which is realized and which also is basically finished for summer holidays. Now, the UI looks similar, of course, because if you only have 30 days, you don't reinvent the wheel. You just use the things that you already did. So luckily, we already did the SwissCovid app, so we could reuse a lot of things from there to realize that. So for us, it was not, the press said maybe they cannot do it, but for us, it was a no-brainer because we already did it, basically. So it's the same login. And it's also two-factor authentication and stuff like that. We also onboarded around 10,000 doctors, which can issue certificates, and also around 80 third-party systems. So every canton has their own testing system and stuff like that. So this was also integrated here. By the way, the UI here that you see is open source. So if you want to develop an app that looks like an official federal app, you can do that. I'm not sure why you want to, but you can. So the The domains that you have here are basically similar to the SwissCovid app. You have one more system. You have the blue system, the green system, basically the health authority, UI and backends, the apps and the backends. You have one more UI and backend, which is for the recovery certificate. Because if you had COVID already before, you only get one shot. And then basically this process is a little bit more Canton-based, so they have their own system. And of course, you have the European Gateway. Now, this integration of the European Gateway is a direct integration. So this time we were allowed to integrate directly. And for the detailed look, of course, we have the different microservices here. Now, if you look closely, there's one service that is not basically deployed on Cloud Foundry, which is the signing service, which is basically the main service. But because of the Luna client, we could not do it in Cloud Foundry itself. So that is developed and deployed on some virtual machine and is connected to the HSM, which holds the official certificate of Switzerland, which is used to sign all the certificates. In Switzerland, we only have one certificate to sign. I mean, some countries are using more than one. Most of them are using one. Some, as a, they have different certificates for the different kinds of certificates that you can issue, but we only have one. So these are also Angular UI plus Spring Boot. The immunity, so to say, system or the recovery certificate system, the UI and backend service is developed in Golang because the team that is that has developed that, they are just developing all the services in Golang. So, but if you have a microservices architecture, of course, there is no problem here. Yeah? Also, Cloud Foundry supports all the build packs for all the developing languages. So that is a no-brainer here. And we also had one more basically company that helped us, which was T&M, because at that point in time, we didn't have so many internal resources to do all the things. So besides Ubik, we had another contractor here. Yeah, I'm not going to them in detail because I think the time is running out a bit, although I haven't had the 5 minutes, no? Okay, still good? Okay, then we can do it. So, but basically the structure itself is really similar to the SwissCovid app. So you have this search generation UI, you have the management service, which is the backend service, you have the API gateway again, which here for this application didn't use only certificates to authenticate, but also because the our security guys wanted to have some personalized tokens, so to say. So they wanted to know in the third-party system who wanted to get the certificate. So we had this kind of thing. You have seen it here. There's generate a one-time password, which is basically a JVT, a special JVT that you can generate and integrate into your third-party system, and then you can send it with the certificate. I mean, the one-time password is a little bit misleading because the one-time password is valid for 12 hours, so it's not quite one time, but yeah, that is the name we had. And we also have, of course, the printing service, because later you had the possibility to let the COVID certificate be printed and sent to your home, at least for the recovery certificate. And that was integrated later. Also, you have the light certificate generation service, because they wanted to have a certificate that is more privacy preserving, so it doesn't show so many private information, your birthday, for example, and stuff like that when you scan it. That was also added later. And of course, you have the Ubique team again, which developed the apps, the wallet app and the verifier app. Later, there was also the verification process was added to the wallet app, where you can verify basically your certificate inside the wallet app. So you didn't have to use the verifier service. And of course, you have some transformation and checking service. And the third delivery service is the functionality where you can get this code so that the certificate is directly delivered to the app and not, you don't have to print it out, it scan it basically. And then you have the interop service, which is the connection to the European gateway. And of course, these are all Spring Boot services, 12-factor apps. So now what was the challenge here? Of course, it was the time, because technology, it was basically the same as before with the SwissCovid app and also with the contract tracing DB for the signing service. So of course, the workflows were new and also the cryptographical stuff, but basically all the infrastructure was already there and was already done. Now, of course, the press didn't know that, so they thought it didn't work in 30 days, but it worked. So, and also the European basically integration was a little bit tricky and time-consuming, but that was more on the political side and not so much on the technical side. And of course, the solution was to use this basically the same teams as before, because in that case you don't have to tell them the platform and stuff like that. They didn't have to learn that. Although that was not true for the T&M team because that was new, but basically it was teams that were already experienced. Of course, you had the platform where you can develop very fast and you have the common goal, of course. I mean, who doesn't want to save the world, basically, yeah? So that was also motivating and weekend work was not a problem. And of course, everything was open source, so we had a great response from the community and also from the security testing, public security testing. Although in that case, it was not so prominent as for the SwissCovid app, but basically it was the same process. So yeah, was it. So there was a happy end, yeah. And now we are top of the league. But yeah, let's see the next project. Okay. Then I'm open for questions if you have every.